Horse Pavlov, Skinner, with the dog training stuff we're talking about. Workforce training, no grades. You know what that means? No competition. We can't have people competing. We can't have anybody better than anybody else. You're not using your head. No brain functions going on there. That's Skinner. There's one area that they all will agree on, and that's the environment. So then they push this thing, UN Agenda 21, Sustainable Development. You could not possibly make UN Agenda 21 work without the limited learning for lifelong labor. Because we all know labor's the key, isn't it? How many charter schools have we put in while you're fighting Common Core? So all of a sudden, these good people fighting Common Core, there are no real schools left with elected boards. They're gonna go to their favorite charter school, and they're gonna find Common Core.
I'm so glad you're here, and I'm going to turn it over to the former Senior Policy Advisor for the Department of Education and author of The Dumbing Down of America. Here we go, Charlotte.
Thank you. Thank you all very much for coming, and especially I want to thank the people who organized this Campaign for Liberty meeting this evening. I know I've met all of them, I think, now, and they've done a great job, and I especially liked it when I arrived last night after the long flight, and there's this great basket of everything that I absolutely adore. I'm not going to tell everybody exactly what was in it, but there were some things that I really did appreciate, and including chocolates. But it's a nice crowd and a good crowd, and I hope I'm going to be able to survive the jet. I've just got back from Europe last week, and it took something like 15 hours to get from Brussels to Portland, Maine. They have these new corridors that the poor airlines have to follow. It must be costing them a fortune in gasoline and all. I've never in my life, it used to take 7 hours to go from Logan Airport in Boston to Brussels. And so I got back, and then of course nobody wanted to talk to me because they thought I had Ebola, you know, because that was all right because I got the flu. And then I thought maybe I had Ebola, but so I'm not gonna go much further on my personal life. Sometimes I really like to avoid talking about this stuff. In fact, here's a really good list. I could start, I really want to depress you all. We've got a list here of communist Soviet agents working at the UNESCO in 1972. Out of 20, don't forget UNESCO controls everything, Common Core, school choice. They love school choice. They've been in favor of school choice ever since UNESCO started writing. They control everything. And so when I read this, I'm not going to read it to you because I can't pronounce all these Russian names. But anyway, out of 20 of them, 19 came from communist bloc countries. Need I say more? That is the American curriculum. That's what you're looking at. And then, of course, Reagan followed up and signed the agreements with Gorbachev to merge the two systems, too. Now, are you going to put this wonderful, this is my speech, okay? You're lucky, it's only 6 minutes. And then you can either go home, or you can listen to Reed Hastings of Netflix. And he's going to explain to you far better than I can why school choice, charter schools, tax-funded, no elected boards are so wonderful. And then I really think I can go home. Because you got me, and then you got Reed Hastings. I'm kidding. I will follow up on that. So have fun. Let's all watch Charlotte. Actually, this is my favorite YouTube clip. Well, I have a few questions for him. We don't ever get definitions, right? I mean, what is substantial change? What is his definition of improvement? What is his definition of long-term change? Who's making these decisions? Not the people. Who really thinks Aspire and KIPP are going to help our inner city and all our kids. Who thinks that's going to, oh yeah, we use them to spin off profits for the global elite? That's what we're looking at. We're looking at a global workforce, lifelong. Limited learning for lifelong labor. That's what we're looking at. And I just love it that the nonprofit self-perpetuating government. My, we should throw that one at the founders of our country. What if we'd had a nonprofit self-perpetuating government?
We'd be communist China.
We would. Well, I love it. I mean, really, that he did all that work for me. It's fabulous to get the guy ahead of Netflix to help me out, huh? Okay, well, so I do want, I'm sure that all of you are pretty well informed on the history of the mess, because I understand that you had Jack McManus in here last week, maybe a smaller group of the with the John Birch Society. I'm not a member of the John Birch Society, but I very much support the work that they've done to educate Americans ever since the 50s in regard to the source of the problem, and certainly about the UN. The United Nations is the problem, always has been the problem, and of course, that goes way back to the World War I and the League of Nations and all these individuals that we talk about, a lot of us talk about all the time. That's why I say there's no difference, basically, between the Republican and Democratic parties, certainly at the top, because it's been planned that way, all the way from the late 1800s, when Carol Quigley wrote the marvelous study, the big book, Tragedy and Hope. And he was a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. And he believed in world government, but he was a great historian, and that book is worth reading just for the history of the last century. But he points out that in the late 1800s, the industrialists got together, and they had their little meeting, and probably in some lovely place like up in Maine, or off the coast of Maine. Oh yeah, we have a lot of those people up there. And they decided that both parties had to have the same agenda. And so that meant at the top. So when we peons go to the polls, you know, you're going to vote for Lamar Alexander, right? And then somebody's going to vote for a communist Democrat. You're going to get the same thing. Because Lamar Alexander is just like a communist Democrat, right? I'm sorry. How many people agree with me? I have a complete, solid audience tonight. All right, let's see if I can think of some more. Oh, how about, the one that begins with G? Is it your governor? H. H. How many people like him? Oh, there's a guy back there who likes Haslam. Oh, you better watch out. You're going to be lynched in this crowd. So anyway, you've got your buddies. I, of course, know of one that's a very, very low undercover agent. And he's very much opposed to Common Core, although he probably designed the assessment originally. And he comes out of Vanderbilt University. His name is Chester Finn, my good friend Checker, who used to be opposed to school choice. In fact, we love that quote of his. He says, back 30 years ago, short of throwing money in the streets, this is talking about vouchers and tuition tax credit, short of throwing money in the streets where everybody can come, grab the money, put it in their pockets, and go home and not be identified. There is no way to have tax-funded school choice without total control. And that is why I say, that's Checker, yeah. He's changed his tune. It's amazing. What on earth do they do to these people? Is it just money, or? I have no idea. I mean, I know him quite well. In fact, I know him well enough so that he's gotten me some good documents, but I asked him at one time about the Skinner method when he was assistant secretary after I got myself fired by leaking the document on technology. I said, well, Checker, what's going on with the mastery learning? Why are they using this on the inner city kids like this? I said, what do you think of Skinner? What do you think of direct instruction and all this stuff? That the conservatives, you know, they got it in. We can thank them for the Reading Excellence Act. in 1990 or whatever. The conservative movement got that passed, which they knew they needed for school to work. So they used it for reading, direct instruction. So anyway, he asked him, I said, what is, he said, well, he's never really too clear about what he thinks, but he just said to me, oh, well, Charlotte, it's the most controlling on the learning spectrum. Yeah, sit, Fido. Here's your dog biscuit. That's pretty controlling. I'm pretty good on this subject because I used to breed dogs and train dogs. Mine aren't very well trained, I can assure you. My dachshund is me trained, but I understand how it works. It's neurological. It's very easy to understand. You don't have to go to courses in Bloom and Skinner and Pavlov and everybody. Just understand that it's, remember, you've had a red light at the end of your street for 40 years. And then the town manager decides to pull a fast one and not tell you he's moving it out. So you get out, you're going to go to work, and they've taken the red light out. Or you haven't had one, and they put one in. But anyway, whatever happens is due to your neurological reaction. So you go flying through, and somebody hits you. You're not using your head. No brain functions going on there. That's Skinner. Easy to understand. It's neurological. Okay, you don't understand that? Been to the doctor and had him say, okay, this is old. I'm old, so, you know. Put your knee up. He takes his rubber hammer. He goes, bing, and your knee goes up. You can't stop that. In other words, the kids that are learning this way are going to be brainwashed to the hilt because they can't go up against the technology which is in the computer. Right? All books, no more books, right? All the books are out, especially in charter schools. Empty the charter schools of books. Put the computers in. So that is, you know, very important that Reed Hastings says, I don't really know how anybody could listen to him and not understand the dangers of school choice and charter schools. Now, what you're going to say, well, don't you have a solution? Well, yeah, I've got a really good solution. I've got two options, and they're both lethal. You want to go home? So, okay, you want poison one or poison two? Well, you've got to have poison two, I think. I'm sorry, but you're going to have poison two, and maybe we can find something to cure it. Poison one is school choice charter schools with unelected boards, which is supported by, surprisingly enough, Obama, David Rockefeller and the Council on Foreign Relations, the Heritage Foundation. I'm going to tell you a little secret now. Which drafted the North American Free Trade Agreement. He's the leader of the conservative movement now. Heritage. Okay, so you've got Obama, Rockefeller, CFR, Heritage Foundation, all the neocon conservative groups across the country. You name one that isn't. I'll give you $1,000 if you can give me one. $1,000, I mean it. They all support school choice charters with unelected boards. Because they're smart, they're globalists, they're just like what Carol Quigley was talking about. They want this global system. They want this global workforce. They don't care about your children being able to learn to read and write and understand Shakespeare. Or maybe being allowed not to learn to read and write. Maybe they don't like Shakespeare. I still believe in freedom. There are always going to be children who, just like I had a son, he's brilliant now, but he just was the pain in the you know what. And the teachers hated him, and he hated school, and now he's, I can't deal with him. He's a lot smarter than I am. And he's very, he'll let me know that too. You know? He has a website called AmericanDeception.com. And so I figure he could have had that without any education, but he had the right to have no education, so okay. If people don't want to get educated, don't force them into the system, which isn't education anyway. It's a total K-12, the American Businesses Alliance. kindergarten through age 80 training. The National Alliance of Business, I got a hold of a letter from them 20 years ago. They had the nerve to put that up on their letterhead. Kindergarten through age 80. You know what that means? That's what we were talking about with my Australian friend who went to the community education conference. And she heard the guy ask the community educator, "What are you talking about here?" And he said, "This is the Chinese communist system." Mary Berry, who was the head of the NEA a good 25 years ago, returned from communist China. This is all in my book, Deliberate Dumbing Down of America. By the way, you don't have to buy anything from me if you don't want to, because the big book, why do I do that to myself? But it's true. Everything is on the internet free. I've had to do that because the conservatives boycotted everything I ever wrote. Right from 1985 on, the little book, Little Back to Basics. I mean, they boycott. It's so effective. I mean, sure, a few people got it. But, you know, say I sold 10,000 copies of Back to Basics in 1985, which told you everything, 39 pages about what was going on in Reagan's Department of Ed. Even if I sold that many, what are there, 300 million Americans? I had hoped that that book would be in the hands of every single parent in this country in 1985, because I told the country what was going to happen. It says right here, look, don't you think, that's pretty smart. I'm a meat and potatoes girl, okay? So what did I say? Back to Basics Reform, or OBE, Outcome-Based Ed. This is 1985, after I got myself fired. Skinnerian International Curriculum, all right? I think I told everybody that. Then I thought, I know the editor or whoever published this said, "Charlie, are you really going to make it that long, that title?" And then I said, "Yes, because they're not going to read it." So I put "Necessary for United States Participation in a Socialist One World Government Scheduled for the Early Years of the 21st Century." Okay, so they could just put it on their coffee table. It's pretty. They don't have to read it. It's 39 pages. God, yeah, I mean, now they can't read three words. Well, but this is a great little book. I just ran 1,000 copies more because finally, after what, 85, 15, 30 years, people are now finding out about this book. It's only $10. I suggest you all get a copy. Copy it if you want. You know, so I'm saying we are at war. And you're going to say, "Oh, well, yeah, you know, there are different kinds of war. You have the horrible one where we have," and you look back at these great Americans, Tom Brokaw wrote about them, that were in World War I and World War II in Korea. And yeah, I was in the Korean, I wasn't in the active duty or anything, but I was over there then. These were the great Americans that really, you know, you find the levels of courage and character that are reached in that kind of a war are unbelievable. You may lose hundreds of thousands, and we have. For what? So that we can give it away through the education system. We can merge it with the communist countries, which is exactly what's happening. I mean, I've got the original document, 1959, on communist education. Eisenhower signed the first agreements with Khrushchev back then in every area, not just education, which merged different systems, right? And in 1959, American educators went to the Soviet Union, it was interesting, a year after Eisenhower signed that agreement, and they studied Russian education, Soviet education. And we were lucky, we got a copy of it. Some farmer in Ohio went to this, you know, to the state policy officer, planning officer, something, and he was looking for something to do with seeds. And here's this 125-page document on communist education that these American educators had brought back with them. And we got it. It's at my son's website. It's got good pictures in it. Really, it's very, very important. And it lists every single entity going in right now. And I'll just spell it out. Of course, Pavlov, Skinner, with the dog training stuff we're talking about. Workforce training, no grades. You know what that means? No competition. We can't have people competing. We can't have anybody better than anybody else. We've all got to be the same. It's a collectivist society, and they're very blatant about how wonderful it is. And it's lifelong. Total lifelong control. And, you know, I read that and I thought, wow, you know. Well, the educators who, I know some of those guys, because, I mean, I'm getting quite old. I really did know the commissioner of education at that time, Gerstner, I think. He sent those educators over. I believe he went with them. But in 1981, when they put the Skinner method into Washington, D.C. schools, the Washington Post had a great article there on the Associate Commissioner of Education, Guinness, said, well, you know, if you can send a pigeon up there to drop a bomb, why can't we do that with the kids? You know, so Guinness, who, you know, Dertick, who'd sent the American educators over 20 years earlier to come back with that study, he said, this is not education. He said, this is frightening. I can't remember the exact words. It's in my book, and it's, you know, and this is the same guy that had sent them over. He said, our children are not nuts and bolts. Well, that was when Spady, see, William Spady, Mr. OBE, the one the parents like most to hate. We hated him so much he finally went to South Africa. And he worked in South Africa. You know, sometimes we get rid of these people, and then of course, the United States has been funding the demise of all education, not just American, all over the world, ever since we went into the UN and perhaps before. We don't want any country to have a classical education. I know we've gone into Thailand, we went into Korea in 1971 with Skinner, OBE. Huh, how many people knew that? That incredible SAFE program, huh? So we've gone all over. I'm ashamed of my country. I mean, I love my country. I wouldn't be here tonight, would I? Or maybe I'm crazy or something. But, you know, I wouldn't be here. I want to save what I thought we were. But we have done terrible things. We are responsible for the European Union. We're responsible for the whole collectivized system that's going in. Of course, it's UN, but nobody mentions that. They call it sustainable development. Look, you know what? I mean, the sustainable development, UN Agenda 21, you know what it really is? It's the old community education that we fought, and we killed it around the country, but it went underground. And they decided, oh, we got to change the name. And they decided, we've got to get the Americans on board for UN. How do we do this? Because they're really giving us trouble. So they said, well, there's one area that they all will agree on, and that's the environment. So then they pushed this thing, UN Agenda 21, Sustainable Development, which without the community ed, and what I'm talking about, this communist education we've got, would be totally impractical. You could not possibly make UN Agenda 21 work without the limited learning for lifelong labor. Because we all know labor is the key, isn't it? And they've got to get our kids. And if anybody thinks that you can put the Cuban system in, or the Soviet system, or the Korean system, or whatever, of school to work and have any freedom, they're wrong. Because it works this way. And I don't think most of you know this. You know, the corporation tells the public school system, the charter school, how many welders you need. And your son, for some odd reason, has always wanted to be a welder, ever since he was, you know, 2 months old. He's wanted to be a welder, right? Yeah, and you know, welders sometimes become great architects and great sculptors and everything. But you say, well, you know, he wants to be a welder. Well, it's very sad when he gets to be 10 years old, and they've only got slots for 10 welders to train in the local shipbuilding we have in Maine. Huh? And he's number 11. Think about it. This is what you call nuts and bolts. This is the bottom line for your children. They will not get the training. Maybe they're going to be lucky enough to be in that quota. Huh? But basically, think of the people who are going to be left out of that circle, the talent that is going to be neglected and never nurtured. That's the Soviet system. Sure, we can say the ballet dancers are marvelous. I love them. You know, the Soviet Union, they're wonderful. But how many other Russian women or men were there who were not able to get that training, who might have brought something else into the field of ballet or whatever? You know, so this is the system that I'm sorry to have to, I don't want to, well, maybe I do want to repeat it. This is what Ronald Reagan did to us. Serious business. He could talk all he wanted about, you know, the city on the hill and all this stuff and getting rid of the U.S. Department of Education, which he did not do and could have done. But when it came right down to a very serious issue, such as breaking the back of our capitalist system, he had no problem going along with Ed Meese and Caspar Weinberger. That's all in the Washington Post, so if you don't trust me, just go read it. It's in my book. We're going to put in the Japanese model, so successful, right? Yeah. And so I think back in terms of the Carnegie Corporation in 1934. That's so important, you know. I mean, if I always say if all the lights go out, I didn't do that tonight because I used, what's his name, Gerstner, not Gerstner, the other one. You know, if they, the most important quote that we have for people to use comes from the Carnegie Corporation's little blue book called Conclusions and Recommendations for the Social Studies, written in 1934. And that is at my son's website, americandeception.com. You can copy that. It says right in there, Carnegie is responsible. It's like Hansel and Gretel. You read that, all of you. Remember Hansel and Gretel? Do they have even publish it anymore? It's like where they went off to see grandma, you know, and they were afraid they might not find their way back. So what they took bread and they put along the way, so they were able to get home. Carnegie did that for me. They made it so easy. I can go through the steps with you on Carnegie, but the major step was 34 when they said we will use the schools to change America's capitalist economic system to a planned economy. And at the same time, think of UN Agenda 21, they said, and we will, in some cases, take your land. Now, prior to that, Carnegie had, okay, let's go through it, funded the National Governors Association. Okay, now all of you, fighting Common Core, you got National Governors Association, Chief State School Officer, all these innocent groups. 1906, they funded, I think, the National Governors Association. They created the Education Commission of the States, which centralized American education completely out of Denver, Colorado. That was, in the 70s. Hiss, of course, was Carnegie. Alger Hiss, the Soviet agent, who got us into the UN and all. He was Carnegie. And probably the thing that has bothered me the most recently, I just finally did locate this research. I only had these two pages out of a book, and I couldn't identify what the book was. And it talked about the use of Carnegie and the Scottish Rite Masons in funding of human relations training for school teachers. Now that is, you may not know what that is. That is the values-destroying curriculum that our children have been exposed to since the 1960s. Sidney Simon, Values Clarification, Saul Gordon, the sex ed. And this came out of Carnegie and UN, Brock Chisholm, Canadian general psychiatrist. Mental health. Watch it. Of course, George Bush, what's he called? I think he called the Mental Health Act the Liberty Act or something. Huh? Look that up. I'll never forget what George Bush Jr., I call him Junior. No, Junior. Junior, when he got the mental health initiative, called it the Freedom Initiative. Well, anybody in this room going to tell me what mental health has to do with freedom? They're going to use mental health. That's key. And that, of course, is Soviet. That's the Soviet system. Beria talked to American students on that. You've got to set up all the mental health clinics all over the United States. You're going to do it through mental health. Chisholm, who was Alger Hiss's closest friend, said we have to have a global conscience. That's the UN, huh? We can't leave it up to you individuals in this audience here to have a conscience, because you don't want world government. Nobody wants it, even all the foreign countries. I've lived all over the world. Nobody wants it. We're all on the same page. So the only way to get it is to have a global conscience. So what you were going to do, Chisholm recommended it. This is all documented. At the same time, Hiss was calling for redefining health to include mental health. Hiss redefined health. Alger Hiss. You know, people, most of you look old enough to know who Alger Hiss was. All right. You know, so Chisholm was his really good friend. And Chisholm said, we have to retrain the teachers to be little psychiatrists. And so it didn't really fly back then. What was that, 1945 or so? It took 20 years, and they got the Elementary and Secondary Education Act in 1965. And that was when, again, Reagan, of course, broke the back of our capitalist system. That was when they broke the back of our education system. They moved from what you know in your head. We had the best system in the world, education system in the world. We moved from what you know in your head to what you can do, how you can perform, which was necessary for what Carnegie called for in 1934, putting in the planned economy. And so that's when they put Skinner in. And that's when they put all these programs into the inner city schools, because they knew they could get away with it, you know, with the minorities. And it's a dreadful, tragic. I wrote an article on that called Experimentation on Minorities. It's on my website, deliberatedumbingdown.com. But what I'm trying to point out here is that we're going to go back to, because I know you want to talk about poison, right? Let's talk about poison. Poison one and poison two. Now, I want each one of you to raise your hands. We're going to do a little classroom thing. Who likes, we'll do it after. Who wants poison one and who wants poison two? Okay. Poison one is the Council on Foreign Relations. It's the Heritage Foundation and all its clones in every single state. It's Obama, Arne Duncan, Lou Gerstner, who said he wants to tear down all 16,000 school districts, put in charter schools with no elected boards. He's like Hastings. We got Hastings. We've now got Heartland up in Michigan calling for Skinner, because they've got this new book out called Rewards. Sit, Fido. Rewards. Finally, the conservatives have admitted they've been at it for years doing this with all the minorities, training them like pigeons and rats. They couldn't get away with it with us. Oh, well, we're all going to get it now, because Heartland has announced this is the way to go. Rewards. So your child is never going to do anything because he thinks it's right. He will only perform if he's going to get a reward. So we're going to end up having a society of animals. We already have enough, don't we, huh? So we've got the neoconservatives. It's really shocking. You're not going to find the Democrats. Well, you know the teachers are certainly not with us. I feel sorrier for the American public school teacher than any. I used to feel sorrier for myself and for the children. You know, I used to say, yeah. But no, what they've had to go through over the years, hiding behind closed doors, trying to do the right thing for your children, and being beaten up on by these conservatives, that drove me nuts in my office. The way we would have all these groups picking on the teachers' union, huh? Yeah, teachers do that. Never the U.S. Department of Ed. Have you ever really heard them go after getting rid of the U.S. Department of Education? Oh, no. No, Reagan didn't do it, so if he didn't do it, it doesn't have to be done. That's what has to go, okay? Now, so we've gone through enough of that. But your option, we're going to do a little thing on poison. Okay, so these guys, they want, the ones I just mentioned, CFR, Gerstner, Heritage, all the other conservative neocon groups, they want school choice, charter schools with unelected boards. That's the Soviet system, workforce training. That's what they want. All right, now you've got the other side, which I used to pick on. Why would I write that huge book? You've seen it. I mean, 700 pages. That's a little one, the Herb Ridge. I wrote this 700-page book of documentation of everything that I knew from having been a local school board member, starting a group on education in my state, being in the Reagan Department of Education, seeing every document anybody would ever want to see or wouldn't want to see, past and present, hoping to alert the American people. Of course, everything I did was boycotted by these same people. Well, I don't blame them. Well, I mean, if your agenda is their agenda, you don't want that information out of. You know, so there they are. That's that. That's option one. Now, option two is the present public, well, I don't like to say present, but the traditional public school system with grades, A, B, C, D, K through 12, not what we're getting now. We're getting now with the RISC program going in all around the world. No grades. You can graduate at 15, 21. They give the major pilot school that got an award in Alaska. The Malcolm Baldrige Total Quality Management Award. Huh? Your kids are cars? Huh? That's going in all around the world, not just here. So that's the charter school end of it. Now, but the public schools are fooling around with that stuff too. I'm not saying they aren't, but they don't want to. The teachers do not want this. But they're being forced out, as all of you know, with performance-based teaching and all this stuff. And so the good teachers are just, you know, dying like flies. But, so what we have that choice there, option one. Option two is doing what we wanted Reagan to do in 1980. He got elected because he promised to get rid of the U.S. Department of Education. And interestingly enough, back then, I believe that something like 60% of the NEA and AFT teachers supported getting rid of the U.S. Department of Ed. And so, you know, that didn't happen. But that has to happen. Nothing good is going to come of our political, you know, well, we're talking about the survival of this country right now because we're talking about elected boards. I mean, maybe you're going to think to yourself, oh, well, you know, like Reed Hastings, doesn't make any difference, you know, it's just education. Well, look, education is number two budget-wise after defense in discretionary spending. That's a heck of a lot of money to be turning over to unelected boards. And I myself know, because we're all fed up with who we have to vote, we don't have anybody to vote for anymore, they're all bad, you know, we're all mad and whatever, that rhymes. But, you know, so anyway, I know that if I have to get out into the snow and go down to the polls and vote for tax collector, when I'm not allowed to vote for school budget or school board, I'm not going to bother to go down and vote for tax collector. So what's going to happen? That's the snowball off the top of the mountain. It's going to fall off, and we are going to lose our representative form of government due to that, really, whoever would have dreamed, school choice charter school initiative being pushed mainly, well, no, okay, CFR. All of them. You know, okay, Quigley's right. At the top, both parties have the same agenda, and that is to use your children to spin off profits for the global elite. That sounds pretty simple, doesn't it? All right, so what we're going to do, we'll get rid of the department. I want to get rid of my State Department of Education like I never wanted to get rid of anything. Go away. Bring it back. Local school boards. Teachers allowed to teach. Go back to academics. Computers have a place, but not until you know you're in 11th grade. Teach them like they used to teach typing. But let's get back to kids being able to do their mathematics and are without the computer and being required to write and to understand grammar and to understand history. And this is what we have to do. Now, you know, I mean, am I a cuckoo or something? Probably. I mean, what is that woman talking about? How can we do that after what has happened? The catastrophe that has been allowed to happen. How can we bring this back? Well, I personally, you know, I want to be honest with you. I don't. It's going to be the most difficult thing this country ever had to do. But look, how many men have we lost in wars and women? Did they lose in those wars that they fought for good purposes? Not this. This is the most serious war we've ever been involved in. And people don't even know it. Now let me ask you something. How can you win a war? There are two things you need to do. I'm going to ask you all. What do you have to do? There are two things you have to do to win a war. You have to identify the enemy. And number two, you need ammunition. Now, the enemy used to be the Democrats up until 1980. They destroyed our children's values. They took the Carnegie and Scottish Rite Mason curriculum and they blew it all over the country into every school. I was there. Maine got the gold medal for accepting the greatest number of values-destroying programs through the National Diffusion Network in the 70s. We got the gold medal, huh? Maybe that's why I'm so, whoo. You know, I was there. I lived it as a local school board member. And let me make a point on local school boards. They are so important. I mean, I have a book by a medical doctor called River of Pollution. It was written in the 60s. Jacob Bean in California. You're going to be surprised when you hear this. You know what he said? The most important elected official in the United States of America is what? Yes. That may sound like an extreme statement, but it's not. When you consider that we did stop a lot of this values-destroying stuff. We did. We had in Maine, and I challenge anyone fighting Common Core, which is going to come back no matter whether you kill it a million times. It's like cutting a worm in half. Huh? Look, you'll never get rid of it because you think you have. You give it a new label. And then while you're fighting it all the time, if you have another 5 years out, okay, Reed, little yummy, yummy, yummy. Yeah, how many charter schools have we put in while you're fighting Common Core? So all of a sudden, these good people fighting Common Core, there are no real schools left with elected boards. They're going to go to their favorite charter school, and they're going to find Common Core. And what are they going to do? They can't stop it because there's no elected board. Got it? Does that make sense? Yeah? So anyway, we're going to try to restore the traditional public school system. Now, I don't know how you really do that unless you just tell your congressman that if he doesn't support legislation, you're going to do something awful to him. I'll leave that up to you. You know. Okay, now, so you have the two options. Now, I want you all to vote. I won't hold it against you. I'm not going to tell anybody your name. Who wants option one? Now, be honest. You all look pretty honest, actually. Now, I don't blame you if you don't even want option two, but I'm going to ask you something. Okay, who wants option two? Yeah, who wants to restore the schools with option two? Very courageous folks, yes, because, you know, we're really got a good, I don't know, it's going to take a lot of very, very hard work. We're going to need as Americans to all get together on this thing. Liberals, conservatives, minorities, Chinese. Who? We've got to understand we're talking about what? Children. They never get talked about. They talk about systems, performance. We're talking about children.
Think about their answers.
Well, you know what? I could go into an awful long one on that. The minute people talk, you know, I told you, I'm meat and potatoes, okay? When people start talking about thinking, all I can think about is Robert Marzano and critical thinking skills, and they tried to get it into our local school district. My superintendent, he had a problem with me on that one. He tried values clarification first, right? Killed it. Then he thought he'd try critical thinking. Killed it. Then he tried decision making. Watch out for semantics, because I'm glad you mentioned it. I'm going to do something on that. Decision making. Children should be able to make decisions, right? Does that sound good? So he called me and said, Charlotte, you wouldn't mind if we put in a course on decision making, would you? And I said, I wish I could look in your beautiful blue eyes, major change agent out of Harvard. You know very well it's the same thing. I'm going to do the seven-pronged fork in a second for you all to understand that. But anyway, no, when it comes to children thinking about all this stuff, I respect you as a teacher and all, but look, how can you think about anything if you don't know anything? I mean, how can you make a decision or think about the Revolutionary War if you've never even been taught about it? How about 2 + 2 = 10? You want to think about that? I'm not very keen on wasting time on that. Oh, that's right. You're right. You see, then you're getting into Marzano. You're getting into all this. This is another area that we could have another conference on. So anyway, I like the way you have voted. And what I want to say here is, I'm going to go through the devil's seven-pronged fork, and I'm going to leave you all after that, and you can ask questions. You're a good crowd. I know you wouldn't be going along with me just to get along with me, would you? All right. Now, the devil's seven-pronged fork. I wrote this about 10 years ago before I... I had got real tired of beating up on Americans on radio. I was saying, when are you going to wake up? Please, I don't know why you don't understand me. You know, please do something. And I got off the radio, I got off the thing, and I sat down and I thought, this wasn't my normal reaction. I felt, these poor people, you know, they have to listen to me all the time. I mean, I feel sorry for them because I just keep beating up on them and all. And then, out of the blue came this message that I really can't take credit for at all. I don't know where it came from. And it said, it's not their fault. And I thought, I want to disagree with that one. I thought, it's not their fault. Mm-hmm. And then, boom, 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 I got this article. It's on the internet. You can type it in, the devil's seven-pronged fork. It now is 9 prongs. But I'm going to go through this with you because only Satan, and I'm not a big religious flag waver or anything like that. I think you've probably figured that out by now. But Einstein could not have come up with an agenda like this, which is the devil's seven-pronged fork. No way any one of us with a logical brain could possibly come up with a manipulative, evil agenda like this. So what we now have 9. I hope I remember all of them. The first one is very simple. It's gradualism. Like the frog in the cold water heated up gradually. We'll just go back to Carnegie or back to Tragedy and Hope. Both parties have to be the same at the top. Well, they're not going to tell you that. They're not going to, in 1898, they're going to have the New York Herald Tribune going to say, Americans, we've decided that we're going to have both parties the same at the top. No. So frog and hole war, we watch this. Every election, we think, who do we vote for? What's wrong, you know? And it's just a mess. All right, that's gradualism. That you can do anything to people with gradualism. Then you have the semantic deception, which I was talking about. I have a good one on this one because I did this to my husband by mistake. Had been married for a while, about 5 years, I guess, and the children were very young. And I threw a red shirt. I'm talking about the dialectic now. I'll go to semantic deception in a second. This is the dialectic. You want something? So you see it all the time. Your governor and all these people that we've been talking about today. You want something, so how do? You create a problem. And then the people scream, high taxes or something. You have every right to scream. And then they do this deliberately to get you to scream. And then they know that whatever solution they come up with, and they go through a lot of them to make sure they're going to get one that will definitely be approved, they get what they want that way. Create the problem, people scream, impose a solution that the people never would have accepted. Now, I did it, okay, with my husband. I put a red shirt in with white shirts. And I knew nothing about the dialectic then. And so all his shirts are pink. And he says, you know, honey, never again do you do laundry. And then the boys, my two sons heard him, they never again. And so I never had to do laundry again. Now, you know, well, I'm not kidding. That is a true story. And so, it's the most wonderful definition. I'm sure that Hegel, because it's Hegel, he might even laugh. Huh? Well, sometimes Germans don't have that much sense of humor. But anyway, I'm sorry. Is anybody German in the audience? My husband's Belgian, so that I can say things like that. But anyway, so you have the dialectic, you have gradualism, semantic deception. That is the use of words. And I was talking about the superintendent. And the way he tried to get the values clarification in first, we killed it. Even with liberals, that's why school board's very important. We were in the minority. And because we got into Sidney Simon's books and everything, we showed it to the liberals, and they went with us to kill it. And that was the day after when the superintendent said, oh, Shirley, you know, how about a course in decision making? And I said, that's smart. You know what they did? The newspaper picked it up, because they used to lie about me all the time. The newspaper picked it up and said that Charlotte Iserby is opposed to students being able to make decisions. Well, that's enough to keep me from getting elected the next time, really. I mean, am I crazy? I don't want kids to be able to make decisions. Uh-uh. And I told him, I said, look, you know, that's, if you were not on the phone with me, you wouldn't dare make that suggestion. You know it's the same thing. And he said, okay. And he scooted away like a rat, you know, which he was. Very bright change agent rat. And, you know, so that's the decision making. Now we got math. You don't have to tell you. We got the Federal Reserve. You know all about that. There is nothing they can't afford to do to your children to damage them, because they've got all the money in the world. You got media totally controlled. David Rockefeller admitted that in Baden-Baden in 2001 or something, when he was meeting with closed press circle. Thank you for keeping our world government plans under wraps. We've got all the money, media control. Of course, I've added, I don't know how many I've done with you now, but it's all over the internet if you want to look at the original seven prongs. But now we have diversion. And that is terribly important, because I'm sure it's not just through Common Core. Common Core is brilliant. I mean, sure, it's serious, and I understand from a lot of you that it has had one good effect, where parents finally do understand something is wrong with American education after many, many years of being denied all that information, which, as I say, if you're going to go to war, you have to identify the enemy, and you have to have ammunition. And the ammunition has been denied the American people. And that was my book, The Deliberate Dumbing Down of America, and this little one, and Soviets in the Classroom. The American people, it's been boycotted across the board. So you cannot win a war unless you have identified your enemy and you have the ammunition, which is research. Now, the Common Core people, if you want to know the corruption there in that movement fighting Common Core, it's that they will not discuss history. Oh, they'll discuss the history standards. That George Washington, it's not nice to say he's a traitor or something. Huh? They'll talk about that. But they won't talk about Carnegie in 1934 saying, use the schools to change America's economic system. Oh, of course not. Because look who's fighting the Common Core. Heritage Foundation that drafted NAFTA. Well, they've got to love Common Core. Because Common Core is necessary for NAFTA. So what liars? So Sorry, they're liars, these people. I got worse words than that. Because diversion is a really sinful thing. When you're dealing with children especially, they are diverting the American people through this, which I think is good. At least some parents woke up over Common Core. But they're diverting them from the Trojan horse, which is unelected boards, which will come about through charter schools. Thank you, Mr. Hastings. So we're talking about semantic deception there. We've gotten into the diversion thing. That article is really the values destruction. That's another prong. Carnegie Corporation funding that. When I found that out, I just, it takes me a long time. I'm very naive. I'm a real Pollyanna. All of you think, I'm talking badly about the conservatives. Well, I am. But how about it? How long does it take Charlotte to wake up? Look, I was a big Reagan supporter to the point where I got offered this position in the Department of Ed. And I've been on this local school board. I started an organization to help education in the state of Maine. I started the first political group in our state. Don't mention my name in Maine now. They don't know who I am. I look in the mirror. I don't even see myself anymore. I am a nonentity in the United States because of the position I have taken on the very issues I'm talking about today. They don't want you to know. And I have to give them credit. They've done a good job to get me so that I don't even see myself in the mirror in the morning. Can you imagine somebody started the major conservative organization in the state in the 70s? I wrote articles. I started the education group. I go down to Washington. Nobody knows who I am. Oh, they know. The neocons know. They're constantly up there moving around and manipulating our governor, who was meant a good conservative governor, who brought Heritage Foundation in there, changed everything. We're all charter schools now. You got the same thing here. I'm repeating what's going on everywhere, huh? So you have to identify the enemy. Enemy before 1980 was the Democrats. I'm not letting them off the hook. You probably think I'm a liberal or something, huh? It took me a long time to get here. They destroyed our children's values, not the conservatives. We were good back then. We fought hard to kill all that stuff prior to 80, between 1965 and 80, and we really worked hard, I was involved in that. 1980, Democrats put their feet up on the desk, and they said, okay, we can now play around in Washington, have a good time, and we'll let the neocons take over, the Trotskyites. We're handling the restructuring of American government, which had been worked on, too, with regionalism prior to that. But we're handing it to the neoconservatives. They're going to tear down the system, representative form of government through school choice, and we're going to let them work, like with regionalism. I could go into a lot of interesting stuff on the conservative positions on regionalism. It's scary. They don't want to deal with it. But so that was given to my office for education. Every single thing that I'm talking about today that you're worried about in education came out of my office. Technology. I leaked the Project BEST, Better Education Skills Through Technology, to the press. I knew I was going to get fired, so I got all the documents out before I leaked it. I got them in my apartment, and then I leaked it, and I got fired. You know what the conservatives said about me? Oh, she wrote that little book because she was sour grapes for getting fired. Well, I got myself fired. You have to know what you're doing when you leak a major technology grant. Was it going to put all the computer curriculum software into every school in the country, and they're worried about Common Core? Did you know that? That the computer software is already there from 1981 on with Project BEST? But I did hold them up 2 years. 2 years, I did. We found that out with a technology journal that said that somebody in the department held them up 2 years. Well, good, Charlotte, thank you. 2 years, better than nothing, huh? So anyway, that was my office. And okay, school choice, my office. Technology, my office. Merging the public and private sector, my office. When Reagan, I was the liaison with the White House on that one, going over, where Reagan, I said, broke our capitalist system by the partnerships. I was the liaison over there.
There's really not school to work. You know, Mark Tucker, National Alliance for Education and the Economy, agreements from the Soviet Union, that's my office. You know, so of course they don't want anybody to hear me. I think I really appreciate all of you. You know, you're here, you're listening, huh? Well, it's not good enough just listen. You're going to have to go out. The ammunition, you can't win a war without ammunition. Has any country ever won a war without identifying the enemy, which is now the neocons, really? I mean, I don't waste time in Ted Kennedy family and all that anymore. I did that in the 70s. That's all over. Your new enemy is the one that is fighting Common Core, and that sounds so good. Because they want you to keep fighting it for the next 10 years. Just think, they can pull down every single public school system in this country with elected school boards. That's what Hastings wants. That's what Gerstner wants. That's what Obama wants. That's what John Ayers in Louisiana wants, and let's get on to him. How many of you here have ever heard of John Ayers? Okay, a few. We have some girls from Louisiana here with us today, and I want to point out they're going to be here on Wednesday and for a workshop, and I hope that they, yes, good. We've got this on, you've all got this on your chairs, and I call what's happening with these girls. We're going to talk about Louisiana here. They've been really activists in the trenches and taking it and accomplishing a great deal, getting legislation passed to protect the children's rights, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm talking about today is, you know the old saying, apple pie without the cheese is like the kiss without the squeeze? Okay. All right, I'm apple pie. They're cheese. There they are, those two. Okay. Without them, it's like the kiss without the squeeze. The two, they are providing the activist part of two presentations to show you what you can do, who you're going to go up against, because they've gone up against these people, the new enemy. They've gone up against them, and they're detested. They've gotten legislation passed. They're unbelievable. I spent 2 weeks in Louisiana this year, and I met them. And I'm so proud that they're here. And I want both of you to stand up now and let people see you. And so I'm glad that I've taken care of that. So the basic problem is to go home. We talked about it, ammunition. You can't win a war without research. It's free, you can go on the internet. Go to deliberatedumbingdown.com and download it, okay? If you don't want to buy anything from me, go there. Back to Basics is on the internet too. Soviets in the Classroom is on the internet. That's the agreements that Reagan signed with Gorbachev, merging the two systems. Carnegie signed with Soviet Academy of Science. Devastating agreements Carnegie signed. And so, it's not that you don't have it. You have it. It's free. Go cut and paste out of Deliberate Dumbing Down. Go to the index first. It's fun. Find anything you want in the index. Go to the page, cut, paste, send to your superintendent. Say, oh, that's not what you told us. Look at the history here. Look what Carnegie said in 1934. This is school to work. They're putting it in. Carnegie's just like, you know, Hansel and Gretel, I talk all the way through, every single thing. The National Assessment they funded, the National Governors Association, School to Work, Change Our Economy, everything. That's Carnegie, okay? So these are the tax-exempt foundations that we've had running our country for too long. 1953, we had the investigation, the Reese Committee investigation. That's at AmericanDeception.com also, 3,000 pages. That was shut down. They didn't want the American people to know what the tax-exempt foundations have been doing. Norman Dodd, who was a good friend of mine, he's dead now, he was told by the president of the Ford Foundation, I'm going to close this, we're going to open up to questions now if there's time. He was told by the president of the Ford Foundation, Rowan Gaither, in 1954, that the foundations got their instructions from the White House. And the instructions were to use their tax-exempt money to change America so it could be comfortably merged with the Soviet Union. And that is exactly what we're looking at today, and they can call it UN Agenda 21, you can call it everything else, but don't call it communism, or you're going to be, you know, you heard great McManus, he prepared you. He prepared you for me. I mean, McManus was great coming in here. That's the story of the UN. And the UN is world government, and world government is communism, and his was a communist. And UNESCO, 19 out of 20 of the education advisors were all communists from Eastern Europe. So what are we facing? We're facing communism in this country. Oh, what a bad word. Shame on Charlotte. Okay, now let's open it up. I'm going to sit down, and I want you all to ask some questions, okay?